We begin our service in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy, and the God of all consolation.
In the name of
he
the
comforts
Father,
us in all
Son,
our sorrows, so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with the consolation we
Lord
have received
Christ,
from God.
The source of all mercy. And the God of
when we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death.
So that
we were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our sister Judy. We thank you for giving her to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us your aid so that we may see in death the gate to eternal life, that we may continue our course on earth in confidence, until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before us, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Welcome. There is a verse where Paul talks about the saints in heaven hanging over the balcony. Judy's smiling and clapping. Thank you. She loved your voice while she was here on earth. And we give praise to God for both of you this day, Camilla and Kevin. This is one of those sad, happy days. And you can't see where I am. You can't see what I see. I am looking directly at the best smile I have ever known, Judy. I thank God for her. I always wonder at obituaries because they're, you know, a few sentences and they're a full lifetime. Just in case you don't know, I'm Pastor Mari Nyberg. I'm pastor of St. Paul's Turtle River Ministry. And I've been her pastor for a long time now. Also a lover of the family and of Bo. So I have to include this dog. Bo jumped into my heart the day I met her, him. And I adore this creature of God. And I'm glad the two of you have each other. This is a short summary of her life. Judy Elaine Halverson Fossum, a lifetime resident of rural Larimore, North Dakota, died peacefully at home, surrounded by her family, on Thursday, December 10th, 2020. She was 78. A committed wife, a beloved grandmother to her seven grandchildren, devoted mother of Douglas, Lori, Sherry, Tricia, and John, sister of Myrna, cherished aunt, and godmother to several special godchildren. She was a woman who lived a life dedicated to family, friends, and her faith. Born in Northwood, North Dakota on March 25, 1942, she was a daughter of the late Leonard and Mildred Olson Halverson. She graduated from Larimore High School in 1960 and earned a nursing degree from St. Luke's Hospital School of Nursing. She later earned a BS degree in English and Speech Education at the University of North Dakota. After working as an OBGYN nurse, she stayed home to raise her five children before returning to school to become an English, speech, and drama teacher. After her teaching career, she returned to nursing and worked in long-term care in Larimore, Grafton, and Park River. She and Daryl Fossum were married on September 23, 1963 at Our Savior's Lutheran Church, Larimore. She is survived by her husband of 57 years, Daryl Fossum of Larimore, son Douglas and Kay Fossum of Savage, Minnesota, daughter Lori Fossum of Washington, D.C., daughter Sherry and Daniel Sletten of Larimore, North Dakota, daughter Tricia Fossum, Dennis Agnew of Moffat, North Dakota, son John Fossum of Washington, D.C., granddaughters, Leah Fossum, Anna Fossum, Mara Fossum, Ella Fossum, and Jennifer Sletten. Grandsons, Aaron Sletten and Ryan Sletten. Sister, Myrna Anderson of Barnesville, Minnesota. Sisters-in-law, Elaine Fossum Poole and Daphne Fossum Greenwood. And numerous cousins, nieces, and nephews. She was preceded in death by three infant brothers. Blessed be her memory. And then there are many, many who have memories. But one particular person sent me something to read to all of you. He is the poet laureate of the area. And Daryl, you'll receive a copy, as will your children. But this is from Alden Lieberg, poet laureate. It's sad to lose a childhood friend. It's hard to hold back the tears, especially when that friendship has lasted as it has through all these years. Our families have grown up together, same school, same classmates, same friends. We've done a lot of things together, but time brings some things to an end. Judy was a real good mother, a very good grandmother and wife. She gave them all the love she had throughout her entire life. She will be missed by many, her friends, her family, and others. Now she will be especially missed by those who call her mother. And it's signed Orpha Lieberg. I'll leave a little space for storytelling or memories, and if you have them, you need to come to a microphone.
Yes. Hi, many of you know me. My name is Doug Fossum, the eldest of the five, as mentioned moments ago. I've got a few words on behalf of our family, and I guess I'd like to title this, Where is Judy? As many of you might know, Dad would say, where's your mother going now? She's always on the run, right? As we'll cover here, she's very active, involved person in the community, wherever she might be, whether it was here or in Arizona or any other place she might be. But anyway, so where's Judy is the theme. So where's Judy? Fargo, North Dakota, St. Luke's School of Nursing. She became a labor and delivery nurse at Deaconess Hospital in Grand Forks, North Dakota. Where's Judy? Bachelor Grove near McKenna. Daryl from the other side of the tracks in Larimore gave Judy a ride home from the Bachelor's Grove Pavilion near McKenna. Some of you might know this, but Bachelor's Grove had been a place, like many rural North Dakota communities, for live music, dances, roller skating, other activities like that, and there's many of them in this part of the state as well. Local community centers, essentially. Not long after September 1963, they were married. Where's Judy? She's in the garden, in the kitchen, and she's now visiting Deaconess Hospital as a patient for about the next 10 years, starting in 1965 when I was born. She became a mother that stayed at home, certainly busy gardening, cooking, baking, canning, traveling around to Hillsboro, Mayville, Northwood, to all of our events, activities, wherever they might be in the eastern North Dakota area generally. But then later on, all the way down to Fargo, North Dakota for activities in the NDSU college environment. So where's Judy? She's at the University of North Dakota becoming an educator. The nest was starting to get a little empty. Three of us at NDSU and Morehead State and Concordia. So Doug, Lori, and Sherry are off to college in Fargo. Mom decided to go back to school and get her degree in education. She became a student teacher then as a part of that education at Sacred Heart High School in East Grand Forks, Minnesota. She was a student teacher there and was introduced to the Sisters of St. Benedict Nuns of Crookston, the Catholic diocese there, which later became a very helpful connection for a future theater performance of Sound of Music. She became a high school teacher then for a few years, speech primarily. And then soon after that, she returned to long-term care nursing. You know, she'd started in nursing, of course. And then she, with her education background, became a trainer of CNA staff, both in Larimore and East Grand Forks for the local technical college. And another thing she did, somewhat related to nursing, she handled foot care for the senior citizens at the Larimore Community Center for many years. People tell me that was a paid position, but really I think it was largely paid for her supplies. She really was more of a volunteer in that role. Where's Judy? She's at the Larimore and Grand Forks Community Theaters. Arts, entertainment, music, musicals with the community entertainers, both the Empire Theater in Grand Forks and Larimore Avalon Theater that have both been kind of restored and refurbished to community theater venues. She participated in multiple community choirs. All of us kids, I recall, took piano lessons, and several of us, of course, also moved on to other instruments as well. And I lobbied for stopping piano, which of course now I wish I hadn't. As she said, you'll regret this. I'm gonna focus on the trumpet. So I did spend time on the trumpet all the way into college, but yeah, I haven't played that for quite a while, and the piano would be much more desirable for me. these days. In more recent years, Judy loved attending theater performances. She certainly acted in many of them and loved the singing and acting aspect as well. But she would frequent Walhalla Frostfire, Chanhassen Dinner Theater, the Chester Fritz Auditorium at the UND campus in Grand Forks, and even the Sun City, Arizona Community Theater. We've attended a couple events there as well. Where's Judy? She's at St. Paul's Lutheran Church in Honeyford, North Dakota. She was a youth Sunday school leader, vacation Bible school kind of organizer, coordinator. She was the church organist for many years there. And both mom and dad participated in choirs, both there at Honeyford as well as in the Arizona community they later joined. Where's Judy? She's in the county jail. She's also at our villa in East Grand Forks, square dancing. So square dancing for mom and dad were a great social event. I recall as a young child, maybe going once in a while, but generally we were not square dancing as kids, of course. She also participated other social events, homemakers in this area, Ladies Aid, Circle Bible Study Group, Red Hatters more recently, very recently a bridge group out of the Gilby, North Dakota area. She, of course, loved golfing both here and in Arizona. Nursing school friends and farm girls were some of her frequent social events on an annual basis. Where's Judy? Barnesville, Seattle. Barnesville, Minnesota, excuse me. Seattle, Washington. Marquette, Michigan. Family visits were kind of the beginning of our travels. I always thought, boy, going to Barnesville, Minnesota, that was like a two-hour drive from the farm here. This is a big trip. And Aunt Myrna and Uncle Carol and Jeff and Brenda are cousins, have resided there their whole life, and Myrna, Jeff, and Brenda are still in that area. But that was a big trip for us when we were younger. I do recall the interstate system wasn't even in place back then. But later on, a few trips to Seattle to see Dad's sisters that lived out there, and then Marquette, Michigan as well. Aunt Daphne lives there. But other travels, many places Dad and Mom have traveled. Hawaii, the Caribbean Islands and Mexico, London, Alaska, South America, the Holy Land of Israel and Egypt, China, Norway, Copper Canyon of Mexico, Copper Mountain in Colorado for a 50th wedding anniversary celebration, Luxembourg, Greece. Many of these trips were with Sister Daphne and Uncle Hank. Many U.S. bus trips to many other places. Dad was just mentioning Florida and Texas. I think the Las Vegas area. The North Dakota Farmers Union organizes bus trips for residents in the area. And they've met many great people on those North Dakota Farmers Union bus trips. Where's Judy? She's at the East Bay Campground in Devil's Lake, North Dakota. Great fishing, many friends from this community, as well as new friends from other parts of the state. Park Rapids, Itasca State Park, Potato Lake, Cross Lake, West Battle Lake, Mantrap Lake, Cragen's Resort, and Zorba's. Minnesota resorts, for those of you that are familiar with the area, annual family gathering typically for the last, most every year for the last, I don't know, 20 years approximately, most every year. So we would frequently organize a trip like that to one of those places. Where's Judy and Daryl? In Peoria, Arizona. Dad's parents, Peter and Ella, and now Dad's sisters, Elaine and Daphne, reside nearby during the winter months in a community or near a community called Sun Air Estates, where they have a community center and a lot of social events there. And they were recent members of the Moose Lodge. Golfing with Sister Daphne is a favorite pastime for Mom. And I know Daphne really misses her for that. Walking Bo the dog, as you've heard about Bo a little bit already. He's been in the family for about 11 years, and he's been a very helpful social avenue to meet folks and get out and about. So they've met many other neighbors in the Sun Air Estates over the past 10 or so years. Where's Judy? Prior Lake Savage, Minnesota, Larimore, North Dakota. She's now a grandparent. Attending school concerts, sports games, and events. Easter and Savage frequently many years, and Thanksgiving at the Sluttons here in Larimore Sister Sherry and brother-in-law Dan hosting Thanksgiving for 20 plus years. Is it 25 now? 24 years so far. And another favorite pastime, more recently for her, she became very fond of our bird feeder watching and hummingbirds and all that kind of thing outside the front window of her house. So where's Judy today? She's certainly watching over us, helping guide us, and waiting for the day she becomes a great grandmother. She has mentioned many times recently, and you don't even need to be married, she says. So, there's still time, folks, so no rush, but she's certainly still waiting and watching for that. She is certainly with us here today, watching over us, along with those that have gone before her. Her mother and father, Grandma Mildred, Grandpa Leonard, Dad's mother and father, Grandpa Pete and Grandma Ella, and then, of course, Aunts Beverly and Phyllis, and Uncles Carol, Hank, Bud, Dean, and Russ. All right, anybody else like to say a word? Okay, thank you.
Wow.
We'll bring the mic back up.
Yes, please.
Maybe in eternity I'll be tall. Thank you. Awesome. You spoke well for so many people, so I'll add one word for the one who can't speak. Woof! We're going to read some scriptures. I will include a couple of my own memories within the words that I share, so therefore, the first scripture is common to most of us, but I printed it out so that we could read it together. Because the one time in my life I really needed that psalm, I was in the hospital and my pastor came to see me. I forgot there was a Bible in the drawer. And he had forgotten his Bible in the car, and neither one of us could get the words to the 23rd psalm straight. He was highly embarrassed and I was charmed because I felt so discombobulated. It was nice somebody else shared that same feeling. But let us read the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Then from Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. The Lord will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time on forevermore. And as we just heard, she did a lot of coming in and going out in many, many places. In Romans 8, who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor rulers, or things present or things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And then this was Judy's favorite scripture. The last time I was with her, she made sure that I read this to her. and it's one to hang on to. When we're feeling a little like this, God chooses us. We don't choose him. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commands that you may love one another. And then from Proverbs, all of us who knew and loved Judy would agree with this text, but I'm pretty sure Daryl would be, if you wouldn't break a leg doing it, you'd be turning a somersault saying, yeah, you betcha. A good woman is hard to find and worth far more than diamonds. Her husband trusts her without reserve and never has a reason to regret. Never spiteful, she treats him generously all her life long. First thing in the morning, she dresses for work, rolls up her sleeves, eager to get started. She senses the worth of her work, is in no hurry to call it quits for the day. She's skilled in the crafts of home and hearth, diligent in homemaking. She's quick to assist anyone in need, reaches out to help the poor. When she speaks, she has something worthwhile to say, and she always says it kindly. She keeps an eye on everyone in her household and keeps them all busy and productive. Her children respect and bless her. Her husband joins in with words of praise. Many women have done wonderful things, but you have outclassed them all. And then there's a couple of promises. The promises, I think that from the beginning of her life, God planted in her, and her face radiates the belief in these promises. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And what is this place like? In Revelation 21, I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, see, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Grief and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away. And the one who was seated on the throne said, see, I am making all things new. Also he said, write this, for these words are trustworthy and true. Let us pray. Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. When God creates us, he puts within each of us tons of gifts. We don't know how they're going to be used. We don't know if they're going to be used the first minute of our life or the 50th year of our life. or the 78th year of our life. And we don't all have the same gifts. But at one point, I really did say to somebody, I think when God chooses someone to be a nurse, he has to plant a particular set of eyeballs in her eyes. Eyeballs that drip love and patience and optimism and kindness. And that's Judy. Judy had that love that just overflows. And that's what's supposed to happen. When God plants his love in our hearts, it's too big to stay within our heart. In the same way, Daryl, is when she fell in love with you, she couldn't keep her mouth shut. She'd talk about you. And just looking at the two of you together, she adored being married. She adored having children. She adored giving birth to children in the OBGYN. She adored going home with this passel full of kids in her arms. And every child that comes into the family, she could hardly contain herself for joy. At St. Paul, she could hardly contain herself encouraging the children in Sunday school and the children's program and all those different kinds of things. I have not known anyone who is so joyful. That smile stayed in the midst of tears, in the midst of pain, in the midst of, I don't want to leave, but I'm going to have to. And the practicality that made sure that her faith was in the God who could wrap his arms around all of us at the same time as he took her hand and said, look what I've prepared for you. What a gift. Part of me just wants to sit and stare at that picture because that smile, to me, is a smile that Jesus would have smiled, the smile that made kids run to him, that made people trust him when they were on the outskirts of life, because Judy reached out to everyone. She didn't do a pecking order of people being worthy of her love. She just loved, and that's a beautiful thing. She went everywhere. There was a song a long time ago now, I guess, that was, I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere. She kind of has been. The two of you have been adventurers across the world. But there was no place that Judy didn't feel at home. And that's because wherever she went, God was already there, portraying and filling the world with his love, often through your two hearts. So, were there lots of challenges? You bet there were. One of the most, it shows in the pictures, and I think it showed in Judy's life. The ones I really thought were cool were the ones of you and Judy, Daryl, where she sort of snuggled up to you a little bit, you know, like, I belong here. And I know what that feels like, because I know the first time when we were being introduced to a bunch of people and somebody said, so how is she related to you? And Ron put his arms around me and said, she's mine. Oh, man. That's the look on Judy's face, and that's the look on your face. It's like, this one's mine. But when you have that experience, you know what it's like for God to mean it when he says, I have called you by name. You are mine. We don't ever have to wonder if we belong in this world or if we belong to somebody who loves us, because the God of the universe loves us first and best and sent his son so that we would be in his adopted family. That's awesome, absolutely awesome. But then what about the rest of the story? We talk about the eternity where God will take our hand and he'll say, come on home, and that's beautiful. But we talk out of both sides of our mouth, and I try not to forget to say this, because on the one hand, in our creed, we believe in the resurrection of the body. Judy will get a new body. She doesn't need the one that's now in this urn. It's all gone. She doesn't need it. She'll get a brand new one
that functions beautifully with no disease, no anything except joy and mobility and fun. Better be mobile for her. However, this place that we go to has some descriptive things. God will be their God. He will live with them. You see, on the one hand, when we die, our bodies are no longer needed. They will be in the ground in one form or another, or maybe in some other kind of storage unit, or maybe even under the water in the ocean or something. And so we cherish that someday the dead in Christ will rise and together we'll meet the Lord in the air. That's part of our belief. The other part of our belief ties with the thief on the cross who said to Jesus, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." What did Jesus say to him? "Today you will be with me in paradise." My child heart wondered about that, but eventually it decided, well, in eternity, there's no time. So for Judy, there is no time. Her eyes behold the one who loved her even more than she could ever imagine now. And Paul talks about the saints in heaven peering over the balcony going, "Good, you can do it. You can do it. Keep going. Good. You're loved. Keep going. Do it." So there's the other element of now. So when we celebrate Judy's life and mourn that she is no longer with us, for many of us, it seems for a moment anyway that the music stopped. And I'm so glad that she whispered in your ear, "Daryl, have this service in our home," because her music fills these walls. And Camilla, you're playing her piano. And Kevin, she's heard your voice 1,000,000,000 times. And I can't imagine the grin on her face now, because she had a pretty big one while she was here on earth. This is the gift that God gave. And to remember the couple days before she died, when all of us were gathered outside, coming one by one to put ornaments on the tree, to wave, it frustrated Judy not to be able to go out and talk to you. However, she could wave, and we saw her, and she saw us, and heard the videos. The gift of God is love, His love poured out in so many ways, in Scripture, in communities, in flowers, in loving eyes. This is the promise and the gift of God. And if you, as you will, as I will, wonder occasionally, how do we ever keep going now without this bright, shining smile active in the world? I think one of the little prayers we can pray is, "Give me a tiny little bit of that smile so I can pass it on to somebody else." She smiled radiantly because she knew she belonged. She knew she was loved. And so we're going to remind each other about the faith that she had and the faith that we stand on. God has made us His people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. This prayer is called the bidding prayer because there is a response after each petition. Let us pray. Almighty God, You have knit Your chosen people together in one communion, in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, and that through the grave and the gate of death we may pass with him to our joyful resurrection.
Hear us, Lord.
Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith that your Holy Spirit may lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days.
Hear us, Lord.
Grant to all who mourn a sure confidence in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may know the consolation of your love.
Hear us, Lord.
Give courage and faith to those who are bereaved, that they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the comfort of a holy and certain hope, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love.
Hear us, Lord.
Grant us grace to entrust Judy to your never-failing love, which sustained her in this life. Receive her into the arms of your mercy and remember her according to the favor you bear for your people.
Hear us, Lord.
God of all grace, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to light. We give you thanks, because by his death, Jesus destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection has opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present, nor things to come, shall be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
And we will pray silently as Kevin sings the Lord's Prayer.
Oh.
There is just hello. There is just one more prayer, and it's usually called the commendation prayer, but I call it the tucking in prayer. God of grace, you sent your Son, our Savior, and so this we pray. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Judy. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light.
Amen.
Let us go forth in peace. In the name of Christ. Amen.